गुड आफ्टरनून दानसुर। Okay, so you are alone. Let us wait for a few more to join. 1 or 2 minutes, we'll start. Okay, we are only two people. Okay, anyway, let me start. So, good afternoon. Today we are going to discuss about one topic: heat engines. The topic is heat engines and conversion of heat into work. Okay. So, in the last class, if you remember, in the last class, we discussed about reversible and irreversible processes. Okay, so today I will upload the notes today after this class, at around before 3 p.m. I will upload the notes. Okay. Today, heat engines. Let us learn about heat engines. So the note is also ready, and I will share the note with you. So let me share the screen. Okay, heat engine. So, what is a heat engine? Okay, so this is in your syllabus. So I got this article, and from here actually I have written your note. Okay, so by definition, a heat engine is any machine which converts heat into useful work. It's a machine that converts heat into useful work. For example, a steam engine or a car engine like petrol engine, diesel engine, they are the examples of heat engines. So heat engines by definition are machines that converts heat into useful work. Okay. So real heat engines are complex, and there are many ways of converting heat energy into useful work. Okay, so there are several ways by which heat can be converted to work. Okay, so there are three parts. Okay, heat engine has generally three parts. What are the parts? One is the hot reservoir. Okay, so heat engine definition you have learned, which converts heat into work. So it has three parts. So I will also explain this figure. So the parts are the hot reservoir. Hot reservoir is this one, TH, you know, this body, red body. This is called the hot reservoir. The other part is the working substance. Okay, this is the working substance, this circular thing. Okay, W. And the other one is the cold reservoir. Cold reservoir means where heat is. Okay, so what is a damping of heat that you also learn? Okay, so let us discuss various parts of a heat engine. Okay, so hot reservoir. What is a hot reservoir? So heat energy is created by some process such as combustion of a fuel to provide the heat energy. Okay, so in the hot reservoir, you produce heat energy by methods of like combustion of fuel, etc., or by burning something. Okay, depending on what is your requirement. Okay, so the place where you do this, you generate heat energy by process such as combustion, that is known as the hot reservoir. This one. Okay, let me annotate here, that will be better. What happened? No, annotate. So this is the hot reservoir. Hot reservoir. Okay, I am not writing the whole R-E-S-E-R reservoir. Okay, somewhere it is written hot reservoir. Yeah, this one. Okay, and then we have working body. Okay, working body is this one. So what is a working body? It converts heat energy into work. Okay, so hot reservoir, we generate the heat. The working body, this circular body, you see, spherical body here, it converts heat energy into work. Okay, in real heat engines, the conversion process is never 100% efficient. So the output is always less than the heat energy supplied. However, we frequently idealize and assume reversibility. Okay, so in the actual practice, so this body, the working body, it converts heat into work. So what this body will do, it will take some heat from the hot reservoir. It will take this body, this circular body will take some heat from the hot reservoir, and it will convert some amount of that heat into work. So WW is the work term. Okay, I remove the annotation because I have to show you below also what is written. Okay, so in real heat engines, the conversion process is never 100% efficient. So what does conversion process mean here? So whatever heat you are taking, this QH, it is not 100% efficient. So all of the heat you cannot convert to work. Only a fraction, only a certain portion or certain fraction of the heat can be converted to work. Okay, so that is why it is written the conversion process is never 100% efficient. Okay, in a real heat engine, the conversion process is never 100% efficient. That means this body, the working body or the working substance, it will take only a fraction or a portion of heat from the heat reservoir. Okay, and then there is the cold reservoir. Cold reservoir means this blue body which you see in the figure. The blue body, which is at a temperature of TC. So what this cold reservoir does, the energy that cannot be turned into work, okay, is dumped and goes to heat up the cold reservoir. Okay, in practice, the cold reservoir is usually the atmosphere. Okay, we also assume that the temperature of the cold reservoir does not increase, it has infinite heat capacity. Okay, So what is going on if we just have to understand this figure. So there is a hot reservoir, there is a working substance, a working body, and there is the cold reservoir. Okay, so this working substance, it will take a certain amount of heat from the hot reservoir, and it will convert that heat into work. Okay, it takes QH amount of heat. Okay, I'm going back to annotation again. This working substance will take QH amount of heat from the hot reservoir, and it will do a work of W, and it will release TC amount of heat into the cold reservoir, which is the, it will release QC amount of heat, not TC. TC is the temperature, TC is not the heat. It will release QC amount of heat to the cold reservoir, this one, the blue stuff, and this is the temperature of the, and TC is the temperature of the cold reservoir, okay, and QC is the amount of heat which is released to the cold reservoir, okay. I hope this much is clear to you. Okay, so have you understood this figure? So heat engine definition is here. So a heat engine is a body which converts heat into useful work, like a steam engine or a car engine or like that. So it has three parts: so hot reservoir, working substance or working body, and the cold reservoir. Okay. Now a little bit of mathematics is given here. So here this mathematical step will include how much at what temperature the hot reservoir is maintained, how much heat is being taken from the hot reservoir, and then how much heat is being left to the hot reservoir, and at which temp, sorry, how much heat is being left to the cold reservoir. So H in the subscript means hot, and C in the subscript means cold. Okay, so at what temperature hot reservoir is being maintained, TH, what is the amount of heat which is being taken from the hot reservoir, what is the amount of heat which you are releasing to the cold reservoir, and what is the temperature at which the cold reservoir will be maintained. So these are the things that we will understand now. And also an efficiency is calculated. Okay, this is the efficiency. Okay, again I am going to annotation. This eta is the efficiency of the heat engine. Efficiency means how much, what percentage of heat can get converted to work. Okay, so let us learn it. Okay, so this is a heat engine. Okay, so in the figure you see schematic diagram of a heat engine. So this is a heat engine. In the figure you can see it well. So assume that heat engine starts with a certain internal temperature U. Okay, so capital U is the certain internal temperature. Okay, it intakes okay, so here they are using I. okay, so when I give you the figure, I will write this term as I. Okay, so here I and F they are taking. Okay, so here H means for hot and C means cold, but they are doing the mathematical derivation here. They are simply considering the temperatures to be the initial temperature and the final temperature. Okay. So assume a heat engine which has a certain internal energy U. Okay, it intakes QI amount of heat from a source at temperature T. Okay, so the source is at temperature Ti, and an amount of heat delta QI is taken from the source. Okay, then an amount of work delta W is done. Okay, an amount of work delta W is done by the working body. Okay, and then the working body does an amount of work delta W and leaves exhaust or leave, same thing, a quantity of heat which is delta QF. Delta QF heat is released to the cooler heat reservoir. Okay, so this is the heat reservoir, and QF means final here. So instead of H and C, they are using I and F. I stands for initial, F stands for final. Okay, so QF amount of heat is being released to the reservoir with temperature Tf. Okay, so with a typical heat engine, we only use the heat intake, okay, not the internal energy. So here, the working substance which is here, it takes only the amount of heat from the source at hot temperature, okay, or from the source at initial temperature. It does not take it does not take the internal energy, okay. So an exhaust, where it is written, okay. So typical heat engine, we only want to use the heat intake, not the internal energy of the engine. So the work is delta U equal to zero. So we don't consider internal energy, so delta U equal to zero, okay. So in this case, we will not consider that no internal energy is taken by the working substance, okay. Let me just write down, it's also given here actually, so I should not write it down. So we will do that no heat intake, not the no internal energy, okay. So the internal energy change is zero, okay. So even if you are taking heat, you are releasing heat, the internal energy change is assumed to be zero, okay. So from the first law of thermodynamics, so when internal energy change is zero, okay, then okay, let me write down a few things here. So it is the first law of thermodynamics. Okay, I am writing here delta Q is delta U plus delta W. Okay, so when delta, when this is zero, because we are not considering internal energy anymore, in that case we can simply remove this term. Okay, so delta Q is equal to delta W. Okay, so let me write down delta Q is equal to delta W. Okay, so this one. But now we are assuming that we have two different heat quantities. Okay, one heat quantity is Qi, which is the initial heat quantity, and the other heat quantity is the Qf, which is the heat, which is Qf is the heat which has been left to the cold reservoir. Okay. So when you are taking Qi amount of heat from the hot reservoir and you are leaving Qf amount of heat to the cold reservoir, okay, that means Qi is greater than Qf. Qi is greater than Qf. Okay. Okay, so what is delta Q? This delta Q is nothing but change in heat, change in initial heat minus change in final heat. Qi minus Qi minus Qf equal to delta W. Okay. Qi minus Qf equal to delta W. Okay. So I hope you have understood this much. Okay. I hope you understood. Okay. So I'm moving to the next step. I'm removing the annotation and moving to the next step. Okay. So what is the next step? Next step is to find or calculate the efficiency of the heat engine. Okay, what is the efficiency? How do you define efficiency? Okay, again, I am going to the annotation. Efficiency is this formula. Eta is a delta W divided by delta Qi. Okay. Delta U equal to okay, so let me rewrite it so delta double U is equal to what? Delta QF minus, sorry, not delta QF. Okay, here they are considering delta, right? Okay, let us also consider delta because we are using the change in work. So let us also consider the change in heat. Okay, delta QF minus delta QY. Okay. I hope you have understood this because I have already showed you the calculation. Okay, now we need to calculate efficiency. What is the formula of efficiency? Efficiency is the ratio of work done divided by initial heat. Or here, it is the ratio of change in work done divided by the change in initial heat. Change in work done is delta W divided by change in initial heat is delta QI. Okay. So, will you remember this? Because this particular formula, the efficiency of the heat engine, will also be used when we will be learning Carnot cycle. I hope Carnot cycle we will start learning tomorrow. Or this week we will finish the derivation. Okay, it is going to be long, but before we learn Carnot stuff, we have to learn some basics. Okay, so eta is delta W by delta QY. So it is the ratio of the change in work done to the change in initial heat, which has been taken from the hot reservoir. Okay. So which is equal to delta W, we have found out here delta W is equal to delta okay, I have done a mistake here. This should not be okay, just give me a minute. So it should have been actually delta QI. Okay, I had written F, delta QY minus delta QF. Why? Because the QY is greater than QF, that we have already discussed earlier. So delta W is equal to delta QY minus delta QF. Okay. So eta is equal to delta W by delta QY, which is equal to delta W is delta QY minus delta QF. Delta QY minus delta QF divided by delta QY. Okay. So the efficiency is change in work by change in the change in how much heat you have taken from the source at higher from the reservoir at higher temperature. So delta W, you substitute this value, delta QY minus delta QF, delta QY minus delta QF divided by delta QY. Okay. I hope this step is clear. Now, if you just do mathematical steps, so it will be delta QY divided by delta QY, which will be equal to 1, minus delta QF divided by delta QF. Okay. So eta is the efficiency, which is equal to 1 minus delta QF divided by change in delta QF divided by change in delta QI. Okay. Always remember, QY is greater than QF. So delta QY is greater than delta QF. Okay. So initial amount of heat is always greater than the final amount of heat. Okay. So we will also discuss numerical problems based on this, and there you will see. Okay. So here is something is written here. Because the engine is doing work, we know that engine is doing work, so that means delta W should be positive. If delta W should be positive from here, from this equation, that means delta Q should be zero. Delta Q should be zero means should be greater than zero means delta QY minus delta QF, it has to be greater than zero. Okay. डेल्टा क्यू इज ग्रेटर देन जीरो, डेल्टा क्यू इज ग्रेटर देन जीरो मीन्स डेल्टा सॉरी क्यू आई माइनस क्यू एफ इक्वल टू ग्रेटर देन जीरो। ओके सो बोथ आर पॉजिटिव, ओके बोथ एंड आई डोंट नो एंड इज नॉट रिक्वायर्ड हियर, सो बोथ आर पॉजिटिव, बोथ मीन्स बोथ डेल्टा डब्ल्यू एंड डेल्टा क्यू आर पॉजिटिव क्वान्टिटीज। ओके आई होप यू हैव अंडरस्टूड दिस। सो द एफिशियंसी इज ऑलवेज बिटवीन जीरो एंड वन। Okay, so something new you have to learn today, that the efficiency of a heat engine is always between 0 and 1. It is never less than 0 and it is never greater than 1. So the efficiency of a heat engine has always to be between the values of 0 and 1. Okay. So, have you understood this? So, if no sound, you cannot hear me. Hello, no, my mic is on. No sound is coming. Why? So, can you hear me? Others can hear me. Can you confirm? Can others hear me? Somebody confirm. Raihan is having problem. He says it's buffering. Others, can you hear me? Okay, Dansurang says clear. Okay, anyway, I am recording the video, and I will upload this in Google Classroom. Okay, I will upload it today. So you have to give me some time. Maybe by 3 p.m. I will upload this to Google Classroom, and then you can have access to the video. Okay. Anyway, so I'll also give you the note and also upload this video. Okay, so I hope you have understood. So efficiency is between 0 and 1. And the quantities which are involved in efficiency, delta W and delta QI, both should be positive quantities. Remember, delta W cannot be greater than delta QI, because you cannot do more work. I mean, you cannot take more heat than the temperature of the source. Okay, you can always take less heat than the temperature of the source. Okay, so that's why it is between 0 and 1. So I hope this is an important thing to understand, and also this will be required when we will be learning about Carnot cycle. Okay, so I'm removing this annotation, and I hope this topic is also covered now. So let me check what I can teach. Okay, let us start Carnot cycle. Okay, so I'm stopping this share, and related to this is the Carnot cycle. So I am showing you some document related to Carnot cycle. Okay, so we are starting in fact a very long topic, because it also involves a lot of derivations. So you now understand very well. Okay, today we start, and tomorrow maybe we'll end up. So is this meeting locked? Okay, let me share. Carnot reversible heat engine. Okay, very important concept to know and understand. So reversible process we have already learned. Okay, so in the click something. So reversible process we have already learned, and in the last class, a process in which we can return back to the initial state from the final state with the same number of steps which were involved in the transition from initial to the final steps. Okay, so today I will give you the notes for this reversible processes with examples. So this Carnot process or Carnot's reversible heat engine, it's follows something called this Carnot cycle. Okay, it's a cyclic process, so reversible process. So it's like this, no? A to B, B to C, C to D, D to A. Okay. So what are this isothermal, adiabatic? What is the work done? These things we'll learn. Okay. Let me see if there is anything else. Okay. So indicator diagram, we have understood the PV diagram. Then we have also understood the area in the last class. Okay. So area also understood we last time. The area bound by the PV graph or PV curve gives us the work done during a thermodynamic process. So that also we learned. So those things will be applicable in Carnot's reversible heat engine. Okay. So okay, let us start. It's going to be long term. Okay. So a heat engine is a practical arrangement for converting heat energy into mechanical work. That is what we just learned at the beginning of today's lecture. In actual practice, the efficiency of a heat engine is very small, and it ranges between 5 to 25%. Okay. So we have just learned that efficiency of a heat engine has to be between 0 and 1. Okay. So it cannot be less than 0, it cannot be greater than 1. In fact, it also cannot be equal to 1. Okay, it can be 50%. So percent, okay, like if it is like 0.5, that means it is 50%. No? Like if it is 0.4, the efficiency of a heat engine is 0.4, that means its efficiency is actually 40%. Okay. So this shows that at most 25% of total heat supplied is converted to one. Okay. So if the efficiency of a Carnot engine is 25%, that means 25% of total heat energy gets converted to work. Okay. Is this clear? I hope this is clear. Okay, so so this is same as what we have learned in the previous topic. So not all of the heat is converted to work, but only a certain fraction of heat taken from the hot reservoir gets converted to work, and that is why we always have efficiency between 0 and 1. 0 and 1 is the number, but the efficiency is actually in percentage. We often express the efficiency in percentage, and this percentage is in general, it is given that the conversion efficiency of heat into work is between 5 to 25% in most of the cases. Okay. Okay. So what Carnot did? Carnot is the name of a person. He is the name of a French engineer. So what he did, this Carnot person, he designed an ideal heat engine, which of course cannot be realized in actual practice. Okay, he devised a heat engine theoretically, but it cannot be realized in actual practice, but at the same time it has maximum efficiency. It gives maximum efficiency of a heat engine, but in actual practice the engine itself cannot be realized. Okay, So there is an experiment involved. In fact, isothermal curve is isothermal expansion is there, then adiabatic expansion is there, if you can see this. Then one isothermal compression is there, and that is followed by an adiabatic expansion. Okay, so this is a cyclic process and it involves a series of isothermal and adiabatic expansions or compression. Expansion means increase in volume, compression means reduction or decrease in volume. Okay, so let us today learn Carnot's cycle. Okay, important thing. So you have any question up to this much? Let me know. Heat engine we have learned. I hope that concept is clear. So Carnot cycle or Carnot engine is also a heat engine. It follows a reversible process. Reversible means we go from isothermal point A to B by isothermal expansion, then from point B to C by adiabatic expansion, point C to D again by isothermal compression. Compression means there is decrease in volume, and point D to E by adiabatic compression. Adiabatic means decrease in volume. Okay, so we'll learn all these things, don't worry. So it consists of, okay, what does this Carnot engine, Carnot's ideal heat engine, consist of? A cylinder having perfectly non-conducting walls. Okay, the walls of the cylinder are non-conducting, they do not conduct, and a perfectly conducting bottom. The cylinder should have a conducting bottom. In it moves a perfectly non-conducting piston. Okay, a perfectly non-conducting piston is fitted to the cylinder in the horizontal direction without friction. Okay, so this is the arrangement. Okay, so this one is the non-conducting valve. This is the conducting bottom. This is horizontal. Okay, it is not vertical, but it is horizontal. This is conducting bottom. These are non-conducting walls, and the piston itself is also taken to be perfectly non-conducting piston. So the piston is also taken to be non-conducting. The cylinder contains a perfect gas as the working substance. Okay, the working substance is a perfect gas. Perfect gas means it obeys PV equal to nRT, like that, and is placed on perfectly insulated stand. Okay, now we have seen that some source is there at temperature T1 and sink is there at temperature T2, and there is something called perfect insulator. And this cylinder will actually be placed on the top of this perfect insulator. Okay, so all these things have been considered by Carnot. Why? Because he wanted to theoretically model or theoretically devise a heat engine which gives us maximum efficiency. Okay. Okay, so what are the other constituents? A hot body to serve as a source of heat at constant temperature T1. Okay, the source is maintained at a constant temperature T1. Okay, so this is the hot body. Okay, a cold body to serve as a sink and maintained at a temperature of T2K. Okay, this is the cold body which is maintained at a low temperature of T2K and this serve as the sink. Okay, source means the body, the hot reservoir, and the sink also means cold reservoir. So we have already learned them as hot reservoir and cold reservoir. Okay, so the hot reservoir is the source maintained at a temperature of T1 Kelvin, and the sink or the cold reservoir is now maintained at a temperature of T2 Kelvin. Okay, something is also written about the characteristics or about the properties of the source and the sink. The source and sink are large reservoirs of heat of infinite capacity, so that their temperature remains unchanged during transfer of heat from the cylinder. Okay, so their temperature, there is no temperature change. The temperature remains unchanged for the source and the sink when heat is transferred from the cylinder. Okay, so when heat is transferred from the cylinder, this cylinder, the temperature of the source and sink do not change. And since the temperature of the source and the sink do not change, therefore they have infinite heat capacity. Okay, infinite heat capacity, you might be confused what is an infinite heat capacity. Just quickly, you recall this mathematical relationship: amount of heat supplied is mass divided by heat capacity is C divided by delta T. Okay, you remember this Q equal to MC delta T. We learned about this formula, or you also learned it when you were in class 11. Now, if no heat is changed, okay, temperature practically remains unchanged. If you are not changing the temperature, that means delta T equal to zero. When delta T equal to zero, okay, temperature practically remains same, means temperature does not change, but delta T is equal to zero. In that case, what will be C? C will be infinite. That means heat capacity will have infinite value, okay, because M cannot be zero. M is the mass of the substance, it can never be zero. But if delta T is zero, so Q will be so C will be Q divided by something equal to zero. If you divide a number by zero, we are going to get an infinite number, which is the heat capacity. Okay, you understood? Okay, I hope this is clear to you. Is it clear? I assume it clear. It is clear to you why we are writing here that that means they have infinite heat capacity. Okay, we have 5 minutes of the meeting. Okay, before I go to Carnot cycle, I just want to explain this figure once again. If you understand this figure, you understand that you understand Carnot cycle very well. So it involves four steps. The gas is initially at this state A. Okay, pressure versus volume. Okay, pressure along y-axis, volume along x-axis. So at A initially, there is isothermal expansion. Isothermal means at temperature, same temperature expansion, volume is decreasing. Okay, volume is decreasing, but pressure is increasing. No, sorry, volume is increasing along x-axis, but pressure is decreasing. Okay, you know pressure and volume are inversely related. Pressure increases, volume decreases, or volume increases, pressure decreases. Then the next change is from B to C. B to C is adiabatic. Adiabatic process, we know there is no transfer of heat between the source and the, between the system and the surrounding, or Q equal to zero. In that case also, there will be increase in volume from B to C, but again, there will be reduction in pressure, okay? Then the next change is isothermal. Isothermal is this curve. Okay, T2 is the isothermal T2. Isothermal compression. Compression means you are reducing the volume. You are reducing the volume, but pressure will increase because we know pressure and volume are inversely related. And the next step involved will be adiabatic compression. Compression means again decrease in volume, from D to A. Okay, D to D is initial volume, A is the final volume. That means there is compression or change in volume, therefore there is a reduction in volume but increase in pressure. Okay, that is adiabatic compression. It moves from D to A. Okay, so this is a cycle: A to B, B to C, C to D, D to A, A, B, C, D, A. Okay, so this is the Carnot cycle. Carnot cycle has two isothermal steps and two adiabatic steps. one isothermal expansion, one isothermal compression, one adiabatic expansion and one adiabatic compression. Okay, so we will discuss it tomorrow morning. We have a class tomorrow morning, so we'll go details into the mathematical steps. Okay, so tomorrow also I am stopping the share. Tomorrow also we will